Good morning. Can you hear me, Nottingham, Manchester? Can you see slides? Been good. All right. So we are back to our study of the Heisenberg group. And we already spent like 4 weeks investigating this object itself. And our purpose is not study Heisenberg group for its own sake, but we are trying to find certain consequences, usable consequences for mathematical analysis, theory of differential equations and operators, and also a quantum mechanics. And starting from this point, probably we may already gain certain results. So that picture in particular can we introduced the co-joint method and classification of unitary representation of the Heisenberg group by means of co-orbits may already have certain physical interpretation. So as I already mentioned, or maybe it's easy to guess, that parameter H here is the mathematical representation for the Planck constant. And so we have here like the classical phase space corresponding to the situation where Planck constant is equal to zero. This is one-dimensional representation of the Heisenberg group. And we also have a collection of infinite dimensional representation corresponding to non-zero Planck constant. And here from the topology, which we inherit from the dual to the Lie algebra, we see that the case of classical phase space is like limiting case for quantum Planck constant being different from zero, but if this Planck constant tends to zero. So phase space is exactly correspond to this point. So we will discuss that connection at the end of our course. Somehow it's believed to be so-called semi-classical limits or correspondence principle between quantum and classical mechanics. That believed to be a very important feature. We discuss various aspects of that relation later. But at the moment, we will accept it as preliminary description or preliminary indication of connection with mechanics and Heisenberg group. And here I would like to say a little bit about my approach to mathematical models for physical systems. Sometimes people use mathematics very utilitarian way, in a very utilitarian way. They just see some mathematical theory which may be useful in a certain situation when they apply suggestions which got from mathematics in that physical situation. As soon as there is a slightest deviation, as soon as there are certain discrepancy between mathematics and physics, people are dropping out that particular mathematical model before any grievance and just either proceed with different model or maybe even without any mathematical strict model, just by some additional tools. So that somehow like an easy life approach to mathematical model. So I believe what between mathematics and physics there is a lifelong relation. And if there is a certain connection between mathematics and physics, then it shall be explored in full details in all consequences. And if there is a certain disagreement, if there is certain problems in this connection between mathematics and physics. Usually it's happened to be a reason for a deeper investigation, and then either a better model will be introduced instead of old mathematical model, or maybe some further suggestions to physics may follow from mathematics. So in particular with the Heisenberg group and quantum mechanics, I believe what correspondence is very close, and that shall be used very carefully and in full agreement with to the all smallest possible details. One of the details which usually dropped out of consideration when we are speaking about mathematics, or even mathematical physicists may drop these things out of their construction, this is physical units. When we are studying in school, usually good teachers of physics explain to us what we cannot add together seconds time and say length meters. So there is no such a possibility. It's a meaningless operation if you try to add time and distance, or do other things like adding mass and length, something like that. So let's keep such an agreement. What we may add or consider mathematically, both mathematically and physically consistent, only expression where we have some of the physical quantities with the same units. And of course, there is no restrictions for the second operation, multiplication. If we want to multiply two physical quantity and they have different dimensionality, when there is no restriction, we just need to keep in mind what result of product multiplication, result of multiplication will inherit the dimensionality which will be in units, which is product of corresponding dimensions in the over factors. Then if we are thinking about functions like exponent, sine, or other functions, then typical the definition for real value would be, or maybe complex value, would be in term of Taylor series, Taylor expansion. So, for example, a Taylor expansion for exponent already used in our course when we described the relation between Lie group and Lie algebras. So that Taylor expansion is, of course, based on sums. So it has an addition as principal operation. And so we need to keep all terms in this sum to have the same dimensionality. If the a terms, the parameter of that function, variable of this function, has any dimensionality, physical dimensionality like mass or length or some other complicated, then powers of that variable will have, of course, dimensionality which is different from dimensionality of variable. And so we simply, in that physical way, will not be able to sum up different terms of Taylor expansion. So functions like exponent, sine, and another mathematical expression have to be defined only for quantities which does not have any dimensionality, unitless variables. In particular, we will consider later the Fourier transform, or things which involve exponents, for example, a character of a group involve exponent. And we will strictly follow that agreement, what parameter in this character or parameter in Fourier transform shall be without any physical unit to be attached. So it shall be dimensionless. In particular, that means if we consider Fourier transform, that product of dual Fourier variables have to be dimensionless. And then physical dimensions of X and Q shall be reciprocal. So they may both X and Q may have physical dimensionality, and they will have in our consideration some physical dimensionality, but it will be reciprocal, and product of two such physical units will give us a dimensionless quantity. And to have a consistent application of the Heisenberg group to mechanics, and particular quantum mechanics, we will assign to the coordinates in parameterization which we use for the Heisenberg group SXY a certain physical units. So X and Y, X will be reciprocal to the unit of length, and Y will be of dimensionality times divided by length and product of length and mass. When, if you will come back to the expression which we have for the group law on the Heisenberg group, it adds to S a product of X and Y, that formula add S product. And that means what S have to have dimensionality, which is a product of dimensionality of X and Y. That will be the time divided by the square of length times mass. And then we keep the same dimensionality for the corresponding elements of the Lie algebra. And then dual space to be dual to the Lie algebra shall have reciprocal dimensionality on corresponding directions. And that will give us what Q and P, which are dual to the X and Y, will have dimensionality of coordinate and momenta. Coordinates have dimensionality of length, and momenta has dimensionality length time mass divided by time. And Planck constant H will have the dimensionality of the product of coordinates and momenta, and that is known as action in physics. So it will be dimensionality of the physical quantity action. And as a physical theory, Planck constant is indeed a constant of the dimensionality of action. So let's review the formula for induced representation, which we obtained from the coadjoint action on the orbit in coadjoint space from this point of view. So that induced representation is based exactly in the form which we discussed before for induced representations. So maybe I will come back to the general formula. Here is the expression for induced representation. So we have a homogeneous space X, and when we, by means of lifting, pass our function to entire group, then act on by the left shift, and then make a pulling back to the, the corresponding space of function on the homogeneous space. Homogeneous space in our case is coadjoint orbit, and we calculated, we already calculated in term of, we calculated what will be the action of the Heisenberg group on the orbit. It's given by this formula, which keep intact without changes the Planck constant, and doing certain shift on QP coordinates, proportional shifts are proportional to the Planck constant. So this is what was kept in this formula as action on the domain of function. And we remember what for induced representation, there is a second component where the part of the group element which does not fit to the domain of function, it's contribute to the range, changes in the range of function through the character. So that is an expression which is obtained in this way. So if you will check that expression by our agreement about physical units from previous slide, you will see what that agreement is completely satisfied on this case. So first component in function F has dimensionality of length. So Q has dimensionality of length, and product of action and y, which is reciprocal to momenta, will have dimensionality of length. Similarly, second coordinates has dimensionality of momenta p plus action times reciprocal to length, so divided by length. And finally, so that function is defined on the phase space, so components of this function may have a variable of this function. It's not a mathematical function, it's a physical function. Components may have certain dimensionality. In front of that function, we have exponent, and about our agreement, exponent shall have dimensionless parameter. Indeed, if you will see here, we have only products of certain parameters S, X, Y from the Heisenberg group by the dual with reciprocal dimensions. So when we take that product, result will be dimensionless. That formula which we obtained here is obtained in a different way. So it's from coadjoint orbits method. It's different from the representation formulas which we get when we consider it subgroups, one-dimensional subgroup and corresponding homogeneous spaces. But I already mentioned what we are looking forward to meet, Stone von Neumann theorem, which give classification of a unitary irreducible representation of the Heisenberg group. And due to this representation, representation which we already built so far shall be equivalent. So that representation shall be equivalent to the previous one. So it shall be certain intertwining operator, which intertwine with representation and build before. And that representation is intertwined by the Fourier transform. We will discuss Fourier transform in details later. It's just now just a brief fact to mention what if in the previous formula we will do Fourier transform with indicated coordinates. And when we obtain that formula 26 out of the formula 22. And similarly, if we will do a Fourier transform for the representation on the one-dimensional homogeneous space, which was built before 24, then we will obtain the representation of the form 27. So that is not a new representation which we write down here. It's just new form of the previous representations. That will be, again, explained a little bit later. but again, keeping in mind our applications, we will call that representation 27 Schrödinger representation. This is exactly a representation on the real line of the Heisenberg group, which was introduced by Schrödinger. Well, actually, not Schrödinger introduced that representation, but that representation is responsible for the Schrödinger model of quantum mechanics by L2 functions on the real line. So this is a connection. For this reason, we call it Schrödinger representation. And similarly, representation 26 will be a representation related to the Siegel Fock-Bergmann signal spaces. So another representation which is also very useful and has a certain useful features which we discuss in details a bit later. Well, now again, as often in this course, we are intertwining elements of the general theory with the particular implementation for the Heisenberg group. So we mention here what whenever you have a representation of the Lie group, when Lie group carry out not only algebraic structure of the group, it carried out analytical structure of continuity or even smoothness. And it will be natural to use that structure, additional structure, and apply certain operations related to that additional structure. For the smoothness, the natural analytical operation would be derivation. And that can be done for any continuous group whenever we have exponentiation, exponent which link Lie algebra and Lie group. We may build a representation of corresponding Lie algebra out of the given representation for the Lie group. And construction is as follows. We pick up element of the Lie algebra, take the one parameter subgroup generated by that element of the Lie algebra, so it given by such an exponent, that will be one parameter subgroup generated by X. That will be one parameter subgroup of elements from G for a given representation rho, application rho to such element will produce an operators on V. So rho from exponent XT will be a family of operators on V parameterized by parameter T. Having said that, for continuous unitary representation, that parameterization is smooth, differentiable, we may look into the derivative of this representation at the origin, put derivative with respect to t, and substitute t equal to zero. This is exactly what we did building a construction between Lie group, subgroup, one parameter subgroup of Lie group and Lie algebra. And we did that formula exactly for the left or right regular representation. So now it's just the same formula for a general representation rho, not only for the left and right regular representation. And as a result, we obtain certain operator, hopefully. The problem is that even if our representation initially was bounded, it was unitary operator, the result of derivation may be unbounded operator. You know that effect even from real analysis. You may have a quite nice function itself, but derivative of this function will be already not defined or badly defined. Think about function to be absolute value of x, a nice continuous function, but if you try to derivate at zero, so it's produced a singularity. Similarly here, rho consists of unitary operators, but attempt to derivate them may, and oftenly does, create unbounded operators. And unbounded operators, if we are dealing in context of Hilbert spaces, require a careful consideration of their domain. So for unbounded operator, we may not consider them as defined on entire space. So we need to choose a proper domain, which is a subspace. Usually, for unbounded operators, it will be not closed subspace of initial Hilbert space. And then appear a problem if you have two such operators and would like to add them. Each operator may have a different domain when you need to look on intersection of this domain and so on, so on. So we need to be careful. And that situation happened even for very simple group. Our favorite two example of a simple Lie group will be real numbers with addition. The probably first group which we studied at primary school. And then if we will consider representation by one-dimensional characters, so e to the power ax, when a derivative of a derived representation for this simple representation is a reasonable operator of multiplication by A. So that it will be a reasonable operator. But if you are looking for the another representation of this the same group as group of shifts on the real line acting on L2 function, when derived representation according to the previous formula will produce the operator of derivatives. And as the domain for the, of where our operators are defined, it's naturally to take the Schwarz space, the subspace of L2 function, which has a rapidly decreasing derivative of any order. So that is an example how that derived representation can be treated in simple situation. When we have the Lie group and we are going to do analysis, we may do derivatives as before. And again, as you know from the nature of mathematical analysis, whenever you have derivative, you become interested in integral. So as opposite operation, reverse operation for derivation. And so we are willing to do similar thing on the group. We want not only derivate representation, we want to integrate representation. And of course, to make an integration in sufficient level, we need a measure. So to be, again, consistent with algebraic structure, this measure to have additional property, it shall not be just any measure on the group, it shall be invariant measure. For example, a left invariant measure will be defined by the following identity. Any left shift of the set produce a set with exactly same measure as initial set. So, and similar definition will be for the right invariant measure. So only the right shift will be used in this formula. So shift of the set does not change its measure. If our group is non-commutative, left and right shift may be a different operation. And then measure which is left invariant not necessarily will be right invariant. And but that may happen. If this happens, if our measure is invariant both by shifts from the left and from the right, then special type of the group are called unimodular. And it's easier to study, of course, group where you have measure which is invariant from either side. And there are large families of unimodular groups. Any commutative group, of course, is unimodular. Compact group, also unimodular. Luckily, our Heisenberg group is unimodular as well, although it's not commutative and neither commutative nor compact. It's still unimodular. But that not really general case. And the simplest possible non-commutative Lie group, which is AX plus B group, two-dimensional non-commutative two-dimensional group, AX plus B group, affine maps of the real line, is already not unimodular. We will not deal very much with that group in our course, but it's worth to remember what really in Heisenberg group case we has rather an exemption from general rule with that unimodularity. So it's a like lucky situation. So whenever we have a left invariant measure, and there are general theorem which tell us what under very relaxed assumption such invariant one-sided invariant measure exists for any Lie group. So for the Heisenberg group, that measure not only unimodular, it's also coincide with the very familiar to us Lebesgue measure. So when we parameterize the elements of the Heisenberg group by with real numbers S, X, Y, we just integrate as it will be just ordinary three-dimensional Euclidean space. So we integrate with respect to usual measure and get integral which is invariant on the left or right shift. And then left and right shift with respect to such a measure produce unitary operators on our LP spaces whenever we have LP space, because measure of the set is not changed with respect to this measure, then shift produce a function with exactly the same measure. So representation is isometry. Having an invariant measure we introduce the operator of convolution. It's easier to define initially that operator for a function with nice behavior, and naturally it will be considered L1 functions, even maybe L1 functions with compact support. when with respect to Haar measure, we can produce such an integral operator, so which called a convolution operator with the kernel K. So it sends a certain function to some other function. And if you will just substitute again that general formula which defined for general groups to the our two example of reals with the shift, real number with usual addition, you will see what will it will be indeed usual operator which is known as convolution on the real line. And again, it's not proof will not be very different if in this general case you will demonstrate that operator with L1 kernel, if function k belong to L1, send L2 function f to L2 function. consideration, so when clearly if we have an operator which act from a space to itself, we may consider composition of two such operators, and again result of composition of two convolution will be third convolution, and in order to calculate the kernel of that third convolution, you need to build convolution of two kernels. So convolution is somehow here is taking control of everything. So convolution is used to define the operator, and convolution serves as the composition operation on the kernels. And then it's again almost the standard check as in the case of the real line to see what L1 function form not only the Banach space, but they form a Banach algebra. So we have on top of linear space operation, we have a product of two functions from this space, which again result into a function in the same space. Now, if we have considered convolution on the group, next we may consider operator of integration of given representation. So assume I have an operator rho, I have a representation rho, which assign an operator rho g to element g, to any element g of our group. Then I may integrate with operators with a weight which is kj, so value of function k depend from j. So when I integrate with expression 30 here, I may consider as integration of my representation with a certain weight depending from element g. Result, if I integrate unitary operators on the of the group on the certain space, result will be again an operator. And for L1 kernel k, it's possible to show what this operator will be even bounded. So if we will make some simple algebraic check, again, that is not very different from what is done on the real line, we will see what this formula provide a representation for the Banach algebra L1. That means if I have two kernels, K1 and K2, and first calculate their convolution, and then look for integrated representation of this convolution, and otherwise I first integrate both kernels, get an operator, and consider when composition of this operator, which is right-hand side of highlighted expression, then result will be the same. So this is a representation of the Banach algebra L1. So that was elements of the general theory, which is not particularly adopted for the Heisenberg group. It's happened to be general theory for a wide class of the Lie group. Now, again, a general definition which appear in various theories under different names. So it's known in the quantum mechanics in terms of coherent states. In signal processing, it may be known as wavelet transform, voice transform. In the representation theory of group, that thing is known as matrix coefficient of a representation, and so on. So, and there are probably difficult to account number of situations where people arrived to the same general framework without even realizing what they simply rediscover certain algebraic structure, certain algebraically analytical structure related to the group. We simply find out what in their particular case certain integrals are helpful, certain integral transform are helpful, and it's only later turn out what way this integral transformed with technique is in fact a realization of some general common approach. And you may guess what if it's appeared independently, so probably there are good reason to study such object. There are probably independent situation where it helped to be, it's very helpful and useful in mathematical or applicable, mathematics or its application. So that is what we called covariant transform. We will first give a little bit general definition, because the general definition allow us to bring under the same umbrella quite different faces of that representation, and then speak about particular realization for it. So covariant transform is defined by certain fiducial operator. Fiducial operator, this is a name which came again from quantum theory. In some constructions such term appears. And it's act as follows. If we have a vector V from our vector space where representation is defined, we are applying to this vector all possible transformation from group representation. For all G's, we apply our operators which transform vector V. Result will be again vector from the same space because we have a representation. And then we put that fiducial operator. Usually that fiducial operator is something simple. It's something like one-dimensional projection. In typical situation, if you would like to think what is behind that formula, would be the such model. I have some shape, which is maybe quite complicated, even more complicated than this one, and trying to take an idea, to take idea what this shape is. I am looking on it, and shape is three-dimensional in this situation. When I look on it, I have a projection to my eye, which is two-dimensional projection. Of course, one projection is not good for taking a full idea about the shape of the object, because there are some invisible parts of the shape for me. What I will do then, how to resolve the situation? I apply the group of three-dimensional rotation. I start to rotate around that object and still keeping the two-dimensional projections of this object, a three-dimensional object, but after rotation. So that formula is exactly this situation. I have an element V. I apply all possible transformation, in my case rotation, and then there is the collection of images after fiducial operator F, which may be some low dimensional case. So in simplest case, probably it will be the scalar one. So we have just one dimensional projection for a vector. So result of application will be certain function defined on the group. So result of that formula 31 will be function defined on the group with the value where we how depending what is our fiducial operator F. If it's one-dimensional, then our function will be scalar-valued. So potentially this is technology which allow us to move from any abstract Banach or Hilbert space V to concrete realization by functions. So vectors, abstract vectors of our Banach space are realized by certain functions on the group G. Maybe it's function scalar valued or maybe vector valued, depending from our circumstances. This is the formula, and let's study some simple properties which follow immediately from this formula. One of the first and very important consequences of the formula will be intertwining property between representation rho and left shift. Just a very simple algebra, as you know, already noticed it from previous part of the course. I do not include calculations or demonstration. I rather just present you with the final result, what the expression look like or how it will be written up. But here proof is so simple, what I decided to put the proof in full of that intertwining property. And it's indeed explain quite a lot of why this transformation, that covariant transform, appears so often, because that simplicity is really represent a power of that algebraic method. So just following the definition, the Waverley transform here, Waverley or covariant transform defined through fiducial operator, and we have here application of that covariant transform to the vector V, which before that was transformed by representation rho, but rho is representation, so two consecutive operators related to representation rho result in the product of corresponding elements on the group, but that what we see here is just a formula for covariant transform for this particular element. And that particular element here is just element H shifted by G from the left. So we obtain the covariant transform, which followed by the left shift on the group. So that intertwining property is demonstrated in four lines by simple calculations. And as I already announced, the covariant transform appeared very oftenly in different circumstances. So how it's used most commonly in the theory of Waverley transform, or how it's used in the quantum mechanics in relation to coherent states, where when our fiducial operator F is simply a linear functional and on the Hilbert space. And that linear functional is done, of course, by the Ries-Fischer representation theorem. It's given by the inner product with certain particular vector V naught. So covariant transform in this case can be calculated according to the formula 33. So we have an inner product of our vector V, which we may think either as a signal which we are analyzing or a quantum state which we are decomposing over the coherent states. So inner product of that fixed given vector V with a collection of vectors which obtained from certain fixed vector V naught by all possible shifts, all possible representation rho. So we apply representation rho to V naught, and then family of vectors which obtained in this way is known either as wavelets or coherent states. V naught itself in this language is called mother wavelet or ground state, vacuum state, if we are speaking about physical systems. So we apply to ground state all possible transformation, we obtain all possible coherent states, or we have mother wavelet V naught, we apply all possible transformation, we obtain all possible wavelets. And when wavelet transform or coherent state transform is just inner product of given signal, given state with the family of all possible wavelets or coherent states. The result is a function, scalar valued function on the group. So this is most known, most popular scheme of application of covariant transform in this case. Again, that example of affine group, which we mentioned today as a simple non-abelian group, non-abelian and group which is not unimodular. Here is the group law. Again, we discussed it with particular group law when we spoke about the semi-direct product of two groups. We have here the group R of reals with operation of addition. When scaling multiplication by A produce an automorphism of this group. So if you are doing a couple of shifts, either you make a scaling of size of the shift and then apply them, or you first apply shift, then do the scaling, result will be the same. So if you have such automorphisms for the UL group, you may build semi-direct product. So semi-direct product of shifts and scaling will produce the affine group. For the affine group, we have the representation on the real line given by this formula 35. So it's easy to verify what application of two operators of this type with different values of A and B will be exactly again operator of this type where resulting values for A and B calculated according to the formula 34. So we just have here representation of the Heisenberg group. When the function which is taken as mother wavelet, that may be a Mexican hat or some other functions or har wavelet, you may heard such words from some popular talks. If you have a function, you take that function, shift it and scale it. So this is all transformation which you have in your representation and apply inner product to the your function f. So that will be formula for wavelet transform or coherent state transform, which is quite familiar from various application in signal processing and quantum mechanics. Interestingly, we have an application even in pure mathematics. In fact, if you will consider the Cauchy kernel, or if you will take as mother wavelet such a function, which is highlighted on the screen now, and apply that scaling and shift to this function, and then consider what will be the wavelet transform with this result, you will see just Cauchy integral on the real line. So Cauchy integral is just particular case of that covariant transform technique. So the difference between Cauchy integral and what people know as wavelet, mother wavelet, is mother wavelet are oscillating kernels, and for this reason they produce so-called admissible mother wavelets. And Cauchy integral depend from function which is not oscillating, so that transformation, integral transform, is of different type, but as you can guess from popularity of complex analysis, it's still useful even and still very important. So not only oscillating,